Oh boy, it worked. They did it. My name is Felix, and I am your host for today's episode of What About It? Wow, today's episode is a big one. SpaceX did the Starship Wet Dress, and we're doing a detailed analysis. Ship 24 is getting ready for the orbital launch, and Super Heavy Booster 7 is about to perform the largest rocket ignition in human history. On top of that, ULA's Vulcan has arrived at the Cape and is getting ready for its maiden flight. Rocket Lab did a first launch from US soil, and Neutron, Rocket Lab's futuristic new super rocket, is making fast progress. Stay tuned and let's dive right in. Starship updates. Cool transition animation and boom, Starbase. SpaceX did it. The January 23rd Starship Wet Dress rehearsal was a huge step forward for humanity's future in space. SpaceX continues to prove that impossible is just a word, and anything is possible with perseverance and hard work. Let's dream big and follow me along as I explain what exactly happened at Starbase, Texas. Stunning views from Chief's YCAM as the world of spaceflight enthusiasts sat down waiting for SpaceX to perform that very first launch practice run. For those who are not familiar, a wet dress rehearsal is a full-scale test of a rocket's launch systems, including ground support equipment like fuel farm and orbital launch mount, fueling and countdown procedures, but without actually launching the rocket. The purpose of this test is to ensure that all systems are functioning properly and to identify and fix any issues before an actual launch. On January 23rd, SpaceX conducted a wet dress rehearsal of the Starship prototype, which was the first of its kind for this rocket. The test was a major milestone for SpaceX and the Starship program. The test also included a full countdown simulation, and all systems seemed to have performed as expected. This wet dress rehearsal was a key step towards SpaceX's goal of conducting an uncrewed test flight of the Starship, maybe as soon as early February. SpaceX aims to use the Starship to send humans to the Moon and Mars, as well as to provide satellite launches and point-to-point travel on Earth. Starship is being developed with fully reusable technology in mind, significantly reducing the cost of space launches and making space travel more accessible, maybe even for all of us. If it works out, it won't just be a bigger rocket. It will change the one fundamental limiting factor in the spaceflight industry, which currently limits spaceflight to very expensive niche products. Dollar per kilogram to space. If this is lowered significantly, all sorts of new opportunities become feasible. Needless to say, I spent the past few days watching Chief's footage countless times. Back and forth, frame by frame, editing, analyzing, and just enjoying the scene. And of course, also looking for signs of trouble. Problems like falling heat tiles or the hull reacting to the stress of a 5,000-ton fuel load. And I couldn't see anything, nothing out of the ordinary if that term even fits this kind of test. The heat shield looked good, the hull contracted under the immense cold, and the ship shrunk a few inches as it got fueled. But still, nothing of concern. The fuel farm did its job from fueling to detanking. The OLM did not crumble under the immense weight of SpaceX's fully fueled Starship, and Ship 24 and Booster 7 performed as intended. Yes! SpaceX kept us informed. Huge thanks go out to the communications team. These messages are very much appreciated. I quote, Starship completed its first full flight-like wet dress rehearsal at Starbase today. This was the first time an integrated ship and booster were fully loaded with more than 10 million pounds of propellant. They added that the test will help verify a full launch countdown sequence as well as the performance of Starship and the orbital pad for flight-like operations. During the wet dress rehearsal, the rocket's fuel systems were tested with liquid methane and liquid oxygen propellants. This means that the tanks that hold the fuel were filled with actual propellants and that the various systems that distribute the fuel throughout the rocket and down to the engines were activated and checked for proper function. It was an important step in determining that the systems were functioning as designed. Additionally, the team also performed a full countdown simulation, which is a rehearsal of the entire launch process, from the final checks before launch to the moment of liftoff. This allows the team to verify that all systems are functioning properly and that the launch procedures are well understood by the team, and also identify and correct any issues before an actual launch. This was a critical step in the development process of the Starship prototype, and it is a major milestone for the program. While countlessly updating everyone on my Twitter account, which is very much worth a follow, questions came up about the huge vapor trails that were visible during the fueling process. They came from the booster's main methane tank, and so the question was raised if this was dangerous. After all, methane is flammable, and the right mixture can create problems. We've seen this before, for example, with Booster 7 on July 11th, 2022. SpaceX had a problem with a combustible methane-oxygen mixture under the booster. It ignited and created a powerful explosion. So if this is methane, can it be dangerous? The answer is very likely no. What you're seeing here is not actually methane venting from the main booster fuel tank. Instead, the long white trail of vapor is just caused by methane. To be precise, extremely cold methane. When this gets in contact with the surrounding moist air, it makes the water in the air condense, creating this huge trail of white vapor. So while there was methane venting from the tanks, the vapor trail is not a good indicator of how much methane was vented. There could actually be very little methane in there, so keep calm and think of Mars Base Alpha. In conclusion, the recent wet dress rehearsal at Starbase, Texas was a major milestone for the SpaceX Starship program. Yeah. It marks a significant step towards SpaceX's goal of providing more accessible space travel. As always though, SpaceX didn't stand still after this. I quote again, after completing Starship's first full flight-like wet dress rehearsal, Ship 24 will be de-stacked from Booster 7 in preparation for a static fire of the booster's 33 Raptor engines. Yes! We could not be more pumped right now. SpaceX's Starship program is so unusual in so many ways. On other large rocket prototypes, we sometimes have to wait months or years for the next step in testing. Not so with SpaceX. It's likely already happened as you watch this episode. When writing the script, I only had the written advisory, and you're likely looking at Sheev's beautiful footage right now. This is Ship 24 getting back to the production site. Don't be disappointed, this is a good thing. Last checks, validations, and ground handling hardpoint removal on the nose are next. After that, Ship 24 is pretty much ready for a launch. For going to space and for demonstrating that impossible is just a word if you work hard. And that's just the icing on the Starship Orbital launch cake. Next, as SpaceX said, we'll get to see the largest and most powerful rocket ignition in history. The 33-engine static fire will mark an essential point in Starship development. Never has such a large rocket been ignited, never have 33 Raptor V2 engines run in unison. I don't know about you, but I'm very much looking forward to this. Will we see the total destruction of the orbital launch mount, or will it work just fine? What do you think? As always, let me know your thoughts in the comments. I'm very much looking forward to discussing it with you. Also, hit the like button now, make it burn, subscribe, share the video, and leave a comment. That's the grease that keeps the Y gears turning. Thank you very much. On we go with Vulcan and ULA's latest achievements. Nope, not Star Trek.
Live long and prosper.
The Vulcan Centaur is ULA's next generation launch vehicle, and it's designed to replace the Atlas V and Delta IV heavy rockets, which have been in service since 2002 and 2004. So what makes the Vulcan Centaur different from those two rockets? First of all, the Vulcan Centaur uses a new type of rocket engine called the BE-4. 250 tons of thrust at sea level. This engine is designed and manufactured by Blue Origin, a private space company founded by Amazon CEO Jeff Bezos. The BE-4 is a more efficient engine than the Atlas V's Russian-made RD-180, and it uses methane. The same fuel SpaceX chose for their Raptor engine, and a cleaner fuel that reduces the rocket's carbon footprint. The Vulcan Centaur also has a modular design. This means that the rocket can be configured for different types of payloads, such as satellites or crewed missions. The Atlas V, on the other hand, was designed primarily for launches of military and scientific payloads, and crew capability was an afterthought. The Vulcan Centaur also has a higher payload capacity than the Atlas V. It can carry up to 27 tons to low Earth orbit and up to 14.4 tons to geostationary transfer orbit. Even a translunar injection, so payload to our moon, comes in at an impressive 12.1 tons. And the concept seems to work out for ULA. At $110 million per launch, the system is cheaper than anything they previously were able to offer to their customers, and results are already in. More than 80 contracted missions are already in the books, and the rocket has yet to fly for the first time. And something recently arrived at Port Canaveral. Up front, this is footage from Jerry Pike, a little-known drone pilot at the Cape. He was so kind to give us his footage for today's episode. If you think that his work should be shown more, as I do, give him a follow on Twitter. A link is in the description. And what you're looking at here is ULA's rocket ship, a very unique vessel used by the Launch Alliance whenever bigger items need to be transferred from their rocket factory in Decatur, Alabama, to Kennedy Space Center. And this time the cargo was very special. Vulcan arrived at Port Canaveral in the early morning hours of January 22nd. The very first rocket will have to show it all. A very important launch for ULA, and one you should definitely not miss. A stunning red flame decal was applied only for this first launch. After this, Vulcan will likely be white to avoid the extra weight of the livery. And even the first payload destined to launch in the first quarter of this year is very special. Astrobotics is sending a lunar lander to the moon as part of NASA's Commercial Lunar Payload Services program, short CLPS. A launch date for the maiden flight has not been announced yet, but there aren't many steps left to ignition. Production and the move to the launch site are complete now. On January 25th, Vulcan Centaur arrived at ULA's vehicle integration facility and has been raised to a vertical position. Next in line will be a static fire, or as ULA calls it, a flight readiness firing. After that comes the payload integration, and then we're in for the big show. Congratulations to Tori Bruno and the entire team at ULA. Seeing a new rocket get ready for its maiden flight is magical, and this one certainly qualifies as very special. Talking of special, we have another launch deserving a mention on today's episode. Rocket Lab launched its first rocket from US soil, marking a huge step forward for the company in providing better and faster service for customers around the world. Founded 16 years ago, in June 2006 in Auckland, New Zealand, Rocket Lab is known for its launches out of Launch Complex 1, located on the Mahia Peninsula east of Wairoa on the northern island of this remote country in the Pacific Ocean. In 2013, the company decided to move its headquarters to Huntington Beach, California. Largely motivated by funding from US sources, Rocket Lab moved to the US. But if you have your company headquarters in the US, it also makes sense to have launch capability in the same country. This is where Launch Complex 2 comes into play. NASA's Mid-Atlantic Regional Spaceport has relatively low activity, giving Rocket Lab access to a very large part of the launch calendar and thus a lot of flexibility in return. Construction began in October 2018, and now it was time to do a maiden flight. And what a flight it was! Electron, being a very unique rocket on its own with its 3D printed and electrically fed Rutherford engines, its carbon composite hull, and its exceptional small set capabilities, is a show on its own. Watching it launch from US soil for the first time, though, gave it that special occasion feeling. The payload? Hawkeye 360. A radio frequency data analytics company and recurring Rocket Lab customer based out of Herndon, Virginia. The perfect example for why Rocket Lab wanted this pad in the US. Why? Because 189 miles are far less than we're sorry, which translates to 8,529 miles or 13,726 kilometers. Yup, New Zealand is a very remote place. So having a US-based launch pad makes huge amounts of sense for Rocket Lab. Sometimes it can be incredibly interesting to analyze a launch failure, but you know what? I do like episodes about successful launches more, even if the anomaly creates more views. And there's not much to say about this launch other than well done. Perfect job, incredible performance from the entire team at Rocket Lab, and a testament to these guys know what they're doing. One of the main advantages of the Electron rocket is its low cost, which allows for more frequent launches and greater access to space for small satellite operators. Rocket Lab's launch services start at just $5 million, significantly less expensive than traditional launch services. This makes it possible for more organizations, including universities and research institutes, to access space and conduct experiments and research. And with reusability on the horizon, the development of the Electron rocket is far from over. On top of all this, Peter Beck, the company's CEO, recently gave some updates on their new Neutron rocket. Much larger and fully reusable, it will mark Rocket Lab's entry into an entirely new market segment with a very innovative idea. Still planning for a maiden flight in 2024, still sticking to the carbon composite idea, and still massive to look at. Launch Complex 3, to be built close to Launch Complex 2 on WALLOPS Island, will give Rocket Lab the capability to launch the rocket. A recently released picture shows two gigantic tank halves intended for Neutron's main propellant tanks. The worker in the foreground gives a good size comparison. And if that doesn't give you a good feeling, here's a comparison of an Electron tank dome in the foreground compared to a Neutron tank dome in the background. A completely different story, bus light year for scale included. If Rocket Lab can make a 2024 maiden flight happen, it would be an incredible achievement. 13 tons to low Earth orbit, 1.5 tons to Mars, reusable, 40 meters tall and 7 meters in diameter. Even if not as tall, that's almost as wide as a Starship. And with 480 tons of liftoff mass, it comes close to a Falcon 9. And with its 7.5 kilonewtons of peak thrust, it's pretty much on par with a Falcon 9. And the trick? Upper stage in a fairing. That's how they plan on doing it, and it has the significant advantage of being able to reuse the fairings without having to catch them or retrieve them out of the ocean. Rocket Lab is one of those launch providers to watch. Big plans backed up by big results. Congratulations to the entire team for getting Launch Complex 2 operational and for sending the first Electron to space from US soil. Fingers crossed for Neutron and a maiden flight in 2024. That's it for today. Remember to like and subscribe. That's how we fund our work. And if you want to get even smarter about space and rockets, watch this video next to continue the journey. Thank you very much for watching, and I'll see you again in the next episode. Do whatever what you want to do with that. All right. Woo! Today's episode, woo? On other jerk, just fine.